Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. I'm Hai Gugaraz with Argus Media. I know you don't have personal control over this issue, but I'm wondering, what's your view on the Commission operating at less than full complement, and whether down the road working with only commissioners that belong to one party can affect or be perceived to affect your work?
The key is that you need at least a quorum. And so as long as you have three or more commissioners, you can continue to do the work of the commission. And we're all dedicated to getting the work done. We understand its importance, and we'll keep doing our work. In terms of the potential loss of a commissioner who's a Republican, Tony Clark, since he decided not to seek a renomination, it really depends upon when he decides to leave. We don't have a date with respect to his potential departure, and so we don't know. I would say, though, that FERC has a tradition of being bipartisan, if not nonpartisan, in the way in which it resolves issues. If you look at the work of the commission in 2015, we issued 1,390 orders. There were only 28 dissents. And of those 28 dissents, so in other words, 98% of the orders were issued without a dissent. And that's when Phil Moeller was still on the commission. And if you look at those dissents, only two of them involved matters in which there was a split with the Dems on one side and the Rs on the other. And so it was far more likely, or you were far more likely, to see a split between members of the same party as opposed to members of different parties. And of the 98% of the orders in which there was no dissent, almost all of those were by unanimous vote of the commission. So I'm confident that regardless of what happens going forward, we'll continue to do our work as an independent commission should, which is to say in a bipartisan, if not nonpartisan, fashion.
Marty Rosenberg of the Energy Times. You said downstairs in your remarks, we should help manage the change, and you alluded to the profound change going on. But given the different perspectives of the Democrats and the Republicans on things like climate change, the role of coal, all the different policies that may or may not be in effect depending on the outcome of the election next November, how hard is it getting, and that divisiveness is probably unprecedented in the existence of FERC, how hard is it for FERC to help manage change when there could be, for example, on the coal front, huge shifts on coal policy in this country based on the outcome of the election?
At bottom, FERC is an economic regulator, not an environmental one. We don't have the authority to issue environmental regulations. And so our focus is on the markets and doing our best to ensure that the markets are efficient, competitive, and transparent. As a result of our focus on the economics, we don't get caught up in a lot of those other issues.
Hi, sir. Liu Liao from People's State of China. So I heard that you have met with the Mr. Liu Jianya, the head of the State Grid of China, yesterday. And just wonder that do you guys talk about any potential cooperation between, especially for the China proposed the GEI, Global Energy Interconnection, and do you see any potential cooperation between the U.S. government and the Chinese government? Thank you.
Chairman Liu did discuss with me his idea of creating a global grid. It is a big idea, a bold idea, and visionary. There's no question. Creating that kind of arrangement, however, would be beyond the authority of FERC. What I did discuss with Chairman Liu, however, was the possibility of entering into an MOU with the state grid. And that is certainly something that I would be willing to explore with him. We have similar MOUs with other governments around the world and with different agencies with different governments around the world.
More questions?
Chairman, the couple of people on the midstream panel yesterday talked about the speed of permitting for natural gas pipelines, especially in the Northeast, and the sentiment tended to be that it's actually increasing the period it takes to permit one. I'm wondering if you track that metric and if you know how it has evolved over the past 2-3 years.
The statistic that I'm aware of, and certainly this was something that we mentioned at recent hearings that we had before the House Energy and Commerce Committee, is that 90% of the projects are resolved within a year after the application is filed with FERC. FERC makes every effort to be thorough and thoughtful and timely in its review of infrastructure applications. And that's important to us, and that's certainly what we try to do.
Yes, Jeff Reiser with Platts. At the tail end of your conversation on the stage today, where you were asked about new transmission, and you said that you believed that, yes, there was transmission was needed. Is there any way you can give us an idea of a sense of how much transmission?
So transmission planning occurs within every RTO ISO, and they do this 10-year look ahead, and those documents are publicly available. But I think in every RTO ISO, they see the need for additional transmission. And then, of course, under the planning regions, under Order 1000, there may be additional determinations as well in the regions of the country that are not in an RTO ISO. So I don't have specific numbers for you, but you could actually look up those numbers with respect to the RTO's ISOs.
Are there any additional questions?
Dan Murtaugh with Bloomberg. I had a question about liquid pipelines tariffs. You know, with so much space trading on the secondary market, you know, what is the sort of philosophy that guides you on, you know, market-based rates versus sort of static common carrier rates?
For natural gas liquids pipelines?
Liquids in general, crude products.
So there's a specific commission order that relates to whether or not a liquids pipeline can charge market-based rates, and there are a number of criteria that have to be met. You know, we look at a number of factors, including whether or not there's the existence of market power and the like. But where, you know, what's your specific question, I guess, is what I, is so.
With the development of sort of secondary markets of pipeline mm-hmm. capacity, you know, where the end user is eventually, you know, either getting a discount or paying a premium because of that, how mm-hmm. is it fair for that to occur with, you know, pipeline companies not being able to charge market-based rates? Mm-hmm. Where's the sort of philosophical disconnect there?
Oh, I see what you're saying. So Our regulation of natural gas liquids pipelines is governed by the Interstate Commerce Act. And that regulatory structure is different than what happens for gas pipelines. FERC actually has less authority over the liquids pipelines than we do over gas. And so that also affects the kind of regulation that we have.
Just if I may get back on the magnitude of transmission investment that's required, you gave a specific EEI estimate or projection that $19.5 billion was spent last year. Do you see, just philosophically, spending on that level needed over several years to come, or stepped up spending? Or do you think we're getting, what kind of investment magnitude-wise do you see?
I haven't tried to quantify the appropriate level of investment. I know that EEI in their projection says that, I believe it's actually, and you'll have to look this up, Marty, on their website. I think what they're projecting for this year, for 2016, might even be a little bit higher than 2015. So they're clearly doing that kind of projection. FERC does not. We certainly look at transmission metrics and the like, but we don't try to project what the appropriate level of investment should be.
Hi, Jordan Werfsbrock with Inside Energy. I'm curious, as information technology starts to intersect with the grid on the end user side and really change that relationship when we're talking about devices in homes, what, if any, role will regulators have in shaping and participating in that changing landscape?
On devices in homes? I can tell you what FERC's role will be, and maybe I should start there. And I think our role will be very, very limited in the sense that we only have jurisdiction over transmission. We don't have jurisdiction over what happens on the distribution side. Many of those devices really implicate what happens on the distribution side, not transmission. So I would expect the states to be much more involved in that kind of issue than FERC.
Hi, Ovunç Kutlu from Turkey's Anadolu News Agency. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, the Energy Secretary, Mr. Moni, said he believes that the U.S. will become the top three LNG producers, exporters by 2020. Do you think the FERC will speed up the authorization, the permits for LNG exports to non-FTA countries in the coming months?
So again, there's bifurcated authority with respect to LNG exports. FERC has certificate authority over the facility itself, and DOE has authority over the commodity. The review of LNG facilities, as you can imagine, requires a lot of work. These are very complicated or complex industrial structures. And so we certainly make every effort to be thorough and timely, but it takes time for us to do our work.
I just have a question about energy storage. What is the direction of regulation that you're foreseeing for it?
So a lot depends upon the market and the extent to which there is continued innovation. When you talk to people in industry, everyone thinks that prices are going to drop. The question is, how quickly and by what amount are those prices going to drop? There are some analysts who think that the reductions will be substantial. more than 50% over the next 5 years, and to the point where those energy storage systems will be more cost competitive than traditional peaking units. So from a regulatory perspective, you know, we can't pick winners or losers, but we can make sure that there's a level playing field for all resources and that there aren't undue barriers to entry. So that I would see as being FERC's role, that is making sure that our market rules make sense relative to the emergence of this technology. Again, who knows what will happen with respect to prices of energy storage, but we have to make sure that we've created the right regulatory framework to allow that resource to participate in the markets.
And this is going to be our last question.
Hi, this is Nusheen Huck with Bloomberg BNA. An earlier panel discussed when it comes to reliability with the switching from coal to natural gas, obviously you can't, you know, there's an issue of pipeline and investment in pipeline for natural gas since you don't have that coal that's stored, you know, for fuel. So with the low natural gas prices, how is there anything that FERC is working on to sort of promote more investment in natural gas pipelines to ensure reliability?
What we try to do is to do our review in a thorough and timely way. That's really what our effort has been. And so that's really what we do with respect to gas facilities.
Wonderful, and thank you, Chairman Bay, for your time. Thank you.
Thank you.